Welcome everyone, welcome back to the Cathedral of St. John Berkman's for our second semester of adult faith formation classes. You may recall all that we did this past semester, and I'll show you on our webpage where you can find some of the information and even some of the videos that we have taken, just in case you missed one of the classes or want to go back to it. In fact, there are many more people who are watching the videos than are able to fit here in our parish hall. So it is great to have a number of people, a little bit of a following, wanting to find out more about our Catholic faith. Now this particular semester, it's all about our supernatural Catholic faith. And we want to talk a lot about miracles, therefore. And today, what I'm going to do is this big overview with regards to miracles. And so I will be mentioning certain things, for example, Eucharistic miracles. Well, we're going to have a whole day in which we will talk about Eucharistic miracles. Well, I will talk about Mary in passing, but we're going to have a whole day in which we're going to talk about Marian apparitions. I'll talk about the Shroud of Turin. Well, we're going to have actually 2 days to talk about that, which perhaps is why you see something that you've never seen before here, a 14-foot exact replica of the Shroud of Turin. Talk about a miraculous relic for us, and how it is even possible that with the resurrection, an imprint of the body of our resurrected Lord was left on that cloth. So that's an example of my saying one thing, but then we're going to really delve into this in March. So I want to remind you that on our webpage, as you see here, that there are 2 different ways in which you can get to our adult faith formation page. So for example, just whenever you see adult faith formation, you can click read more and it would take you there. Or if by chance there's nothing that mentions it, you can always go to education, adult faith formation, and it will take you there. And this is, remember we did the Catholic retrospective last year, and it totally explains what it is that we are doing here, all the topics on the left-hand side. But then on the right side, if you have lost the booklet and you want to see it again, there it is from last go around. Here's the current one. All of these on the right side in blue are videos of our talks and some really good links to a number of different sites. So don't be afraid to go and visit that particular site. Now, for us today, it's all about miracles, and I just wanted to show you 2 different things that I found out of so many. Some really neat, wrong one, quotes that we have. So Albert Einstein, of all people, you know, he was considered the man of the millennium, remember, in the year 2000. Well, he says that there are only 2 ways to live your life. One is as though nothing is a miracle, and the other is if everything is a miracle. I mean, imagine living your life as if, there's no miracles, there's nothing special, supernatural, whatever. Or everything in your life, every moment of your life, everything that happens, every relationship, everything is a miracle. And then I just also found this simple thing. I am a realist. I expect miracles. You know, we are people of faith. We should be very realistic. And out of our understanding of faith and what God can do, we should expect miracles. In fact, for nothing shall be impossible for God. I mean, straight from sacred scripture. I can do all things in Christ who strengthens me, St. Paul. All things. So we need to really have a beautiful understanding of the supernatural in our faith. And even when we talk about the natural, of course, a person of faith can say, okay, so the natural, well, how did the natural come about? And of course, there are all sorts of theories, but we understand our understanding of creation. Now, next door, and I don't mean the cathedral, I mean on the other side of it, Loyola, we're getting a lot of people who, you know, it's a, this day and age where faith and science, they're starting to question, well, you know, how can we scientifically prove this? And one of the things that I get to do as their chaplain is when I'm preaching, usually it's going to be in the context of a mass, I get to talk to them about how it is that these are not opposed to each other, but that they go hand in hand and beautifully hand in hand. And how it is that Pope St. John Paul II said that both, you know, faith and reason, you know, faith and science, these are as if two wings that help the soul fly to God. So one of the things that we will do in the context of our discussion of the supernatural is we're going to talk about what seems to be the natural, the scientific. So with all of that, let me get straight to our slideshow. Okay, so. Thank you. Actually, before we do that, I do want to make one other, at least a little bit of an announcement, and that is what you see over here. As also part of our adult faith formation, but citywide, St. Joseph's, St. Elizabeth Ann Seton, and the Cathedral Parish have gone in together to offer this year-long presentation, God and Sex, is the Catholic Church Out of Touch? Remember, this is the 50th anniversary of Humanae Vitae. And so what we want to do is take a look at that particular document. And so the human sexuality from a number of different points of view, as Blessed Paul VI wrote about 50 years ago. So some of the presenters are local, others are international, national speakers who are coming here. And the actual anniversary was on the 25th of July. So we're using the 25th as the date. So January 25th, February 25th, it's going to be different days of the week, but just put down on your calendar the 25th of every single month, except for Christmas, and know that we will have some type of a presentation with regards to this whole notion, God and sex is the Catholic Church out of touch. Bishop Duca is going to start it all off, and that will be at St. Joseph's, the Courage to be Catholic. We have this, I don't know if it's in our current bulletin, but we have had this in the bulletins, where I've seen people literally with their iPhones go up and take a picture of it, so you've got it on your phone and you know what all the different topics are. February 25th, the speaker will be here, Dr. David Parker. And so I really, really hope that you'll take this as an opportunity for your adult faith formation here at the Cathedral and at St. Joseph's. It's never at St. Elizabeth Ann Seton, even though they're one of our sponsor parishes. Now, miracles, dare to believe. And I put up right under there, at the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say. What are the next words?
Our Father.
Our Father. Good. All right. But we dare to say. In fact, early on with the new translation of the Roman Missal, some people had some issues with any number of things, but this was one of them. What do you mean we have to dare? You know, we just say it. There's no daring, but from the point of view of what it is that we are about to say, acknowledging that there is a God and that He is our Father and that He is in heaven and that we want to keep holy His name, et cetera, et cetera. I mean, this is a daring proposition. It's in some regard an unbelievable leap of faith, because we don't see God as God and we don't see God as Father. There has to be something between what we see and what we are able to comprehend with our faith. Some of the things that we'll get next door at Loyola, or I shouldn't pick on Loyola. There's some great kids over there. But a lot of people, it's like, okay, once I have a good understanding of everything that the church is trying to teach, then I will believe. So it's like, once I'm able to fit God into my brain, once I am able to understand, then I will believe. And yet I keep telling them, I don't want a God that I can fit in my brain. You know, I want a God that's so unbelievably huge, infinite, grand, who is giving me avenues by which I am able to believe, in which I'm able to make this leap of faith and say, yes, I want to completely give myself over to whatever the particular belief is. And of course, the very famous saying, fides quaerens intellectum, it's faith that seeks understanding. A lot of people, it's once I have the understanding, then I'm going to, my understanding, I'm going to seek faith. Well, again, we as people who are part of the faith, once we have faith, now all of a sudden things open up. Now it's as if the world can make sense. One of the images that has been used before is kind of like with our cathedral. You know, from this point of view, you look over there, you see the stained glass windows. You know that they're stained glass windows, but you have no earthly idea what they are. You know, you can kind of make out a few designs, but not really. But once you are on the inside, once you're an insider, as it were, then all of a sudden the light that hits, it makes sense. I can see the beauty of the windows. And oftentimes that's an experience that a number of people in our RCIA have. It's they have faith, but Lord help my unbelief. And once you're an insider, once you're participating in the life of the church, once you are receiving the sacraments, then everything starts to really come together in a very beautiful way. So the role of miracles in our faith. So, miracles occur not for the believer, but for those who do not yet believe. St. Thomas Aquinas. The miracles are not there for the benefit of those who believe. I mean, I guess it might help our faith, confirm us in our faith, but the miracles at the time of Jesus Christ were signs that were needed to say the kingdom of God is here. You cannot see it. And I'll speak far more about this in just a moment. St. Augustine, miracles were necessary before the world believed in order that it might believe. The miracles worked by our Lord Jesus Christ are divine works which raise the human mind above the visible, above visible things to understand what is divine. The people who experienced these miracles understood that there is more to truth than what is found in the natural order. We know that we have bodies, but we also know that we have souls, and the soul would be in the supernatural order. Human destiny is the kingdom of God, and Christ's miracles are signs of that kingdom. Oftentimes you'll hear the word signs or wonders as a synonym for miracle. So, what is a miracle? Let's take a look at the Latin. It means something that is a wonder or a sight to behold. And so that's why, again, oftentimes we might just see in Scripture or even in the Catechism itself, and I'll get there, that's the title of this class, Miracles in the Catechism, it will use the word wonders or it will use the word sign. A supernatural sign or wonder brought about by God, signifying His glory and the salvation of mankind. So supernatural, above the natural, something that is not naturally perceived. Something of the natural world is natural. It's not supernatural. Something of the something that is supernatural brought about by God. So here the life of the world is coming in, and God inserts himself at this particular moment in a way that otherwise would not be perceived by us, would not, something that would have not been able to occur had it not been by some divine intervention. And there are plenty of examples of this in sacred scripture, which we'll get to. This is the overview of the overview. Something not brought about by created beings, by us. So that if it's something that we can do, we know it's not per se a miracle. Now, some people would say, well, it is a miracle because we ourselves are miracles who have been given life by God and we have been given talents and are able to use our intellect to bring things about. We're talking about miracles and that faith-based sense. Therefore, it is a sign. So a sign, a wonder, a miracle. As a sign, a miracle is perceived by the senses and makes present the supernatural order, God's governance of nature, and his loving plan of salvation. So the only way that anything can get into our brains, can get into our souls, is by means of our five senses. It has to be something that is seen, heard, smelled, tasted, or whatever the fifth one is.
Touched,
thank you. So it has to be, so for a miracle to take place, for us to be able to see it. Now, of course, might there be somehow infused knowledge, something like that, so you could say, well, that's not seen, that's not perceived, on a natural order. But with regards to miracles, as experienced by Jesus Christ and what some of the saints have been able to do, because of God, obviously, they are perceived by the senses and make present the supernatural order. Miracles are always a call to faith. That's why in sacred scripture from the very beginning we have miracles. This is part of our seminary class. Fundamental theology is what it was called. Fundamental. I mean, so here Jesus goes around and talks about the kingdom of God. Okay, fine. But he manifests the kingdom by all of these supernatural things. What's going on? Again, more about that in a minute. Faith is the beginning of human salvation. So the Council of Trent, and remember, that's the first catechism. I'll get to our current catechism in a moment. But faith is the beginning of human salvation. And faith is that which is instilled. Miracles are divine revelation. The miracles of Christ and the saints, prophecies, these are the most certain signs of divine revelation. This is Vatican I. Our current catechism is a product of Vatican II. The miracles of Christ and the saints' prophecies, these are the most certain signs of divine revelation. We have sacred scripture, that's clearly divine revelation itself. The Word made flesh, talk about a miracle right there. So, our understanding of miracles and our Catholic teaching. If anyone says that divine revelation cannot be credible by external signs, and that therefore men and women ought to be moved to faith only by each other's internal experience or private inspiration, let him be anathema. So, Vatican I again. So, in other words, what's the contrary to that? We need to believe in the supernatural and not just mere external signs. We need the supernatural to move us to a position of faith. If anyone says that all miracles are impossible and that therefore all reports of them, even those contained in sacred scripture, are to be set aside as fables or myths, or that miracles can never be known with certainty, nor can the divine origin of the Christian religion be proved from them, let him be anathema. I mean, that's that was certainly a an early way of speaking about those who do not believe, obviously. But if anyone says that miracles are impossible, so we all have to say miracles are possible. We know that they are. And even in sacred scripture, I mean, have you ever read anything or heard someone who will talk about a certain miracle in the Bible and then try to explain it away, how it was actually a natural occurrence? You know, and Jesus didn't really walk on water. This is how it happened. Try to explain it naturally. Or Moses and the Red Sea, because there are miracles that took place in the Old Testament as well. This is not just a New Testament thing. That really it was a natural thing, and a wind kicked up, and which enabled them just to walk across. Or the multiplication of loaves. He really didn't multiply the loaves. This is an example of everyone actually had enough food, but they didn't really begin sharing the food that they had until Andrew and the apostles start going out with the fish and loaves of bread. You know, we don't want to explain away our faith. We don't need to say this is how it had to have happened on a natural order, because we believe in a supernatural order. Jesus promised his disciples that they would perform even greater miracles than he, but in his name, not by their power. That's in sacred scripture. We have to believe that his apostles and those who follow him are able in the name of God to perform miracles. And there's plenty of examples of them. We're about to get to them. Amen, amen, I say to you, he that believeth in me, the works that I do, he shall do even greater than these. So John 14. So miracles have been with the church since the beginning. So as I mentioned, yes, in the Old Testament, Judaism, Moses, the prophets, so the miracles of Jesus. So a couple of days ago, the first Friday, first week of Ordinary Time, Gospel Paralytic. So I actually have it on there, but I think you know the story. The four people bring the paralytic, open up the roof, lower him down there. And the first thing that Jesus says to this man is, pick up your mat and walk. First thing is, because of their faith, your sins are forgiven. They're looking for a miracle. They're looking for a physical miracle. Why? Because things have already started to happen. This is a great time of a liturgical season. We just finished Christmas. We had the baptism of the Lord. Now Jesus is preaching and doing his miracles. We're not hearing about the passion. We're not hearing about the controversy. We're not, you know, so we get to hear the early parts of all the gospel readings, and this is one of them. And so, but what does Jesus say? So what is easier for me to say your sins are forgiven or rise, pick up your mat and walk? And so on the natural order, we would say, well, it's pick up your mat. I mean, that's easier. And so Jesus says, so that you know that the Son of Man has the power to forgive sins, boom, he performs this miracle. There's the purpose behind miracles. So that you can actually believe everything else that Jesus says. Jesus says, I can forgive sins. Okay, really? Okay. Here, let me show you that I have power over the physical realm. And we see that in many other places in Scripture. As he's walking over water, and they think he's a ghost. He says, be quiet, and then all of a sudden the wind is stilled. He takes water. This is the first of his signs, and that's what they call it, a sign. The first of his signs was changing water into wine. Can water become wine? I mean, in one sense, over a very long process, you take water, and then what else do you take? You take this... the grapes, the fermentation process, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, everything that we have to do to it, and it can create wine. Jesus, boom, right immediately, there's something that totally breaks the natural order, and that's how we have a miracle. The miracles of the apostles and saints, as is mentioned in sacred scripture. So we have the signs and wonders, apostolic foundation of miracles, since Pentecost, Jesus said that we'd be able to do miracles. And then with the, I think of Pentecost and the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, St. Peter is speaking, but everyone of all the different nationalities is understanding in their own language. St. Peter and St. John cure that lame man. They're the ones who were there. Of course, in the name of God, in the name of our of the Lord, even the shadow of St. Peter healed many. They just wanted to get close to him, and he walked by, and there's a shadow, it hits him, and they are cured. Again, the people are able to see this experience, see a miracle, and therefore are able, therefore, hopefully, this is the goal, to make that leap of faith to say that everything else that Jesus is saying must be true. The clothes of St. Paul healed many. Think about the miracles in the life of the church, and I think everyone knows about all these different things about St. Patrick, St. Francis Xavier. St. Francis Xavier, in the church, with his word of authority, expelling demons of those who were possessed. And then there are other, so many of the greats. So Our Lady of Guadalupe. Remember, Mary appears and miracles happen to people of unbelief or so lacking in their belief. And in 1531, all that took place because of that Marian apparition. Hopefully everyone knows the story well. St. Francis of Assisi. Here's someone who so wanted to conform himself to the life of Christ that all of a sudden he gets the stigmata. This was not natural. This is supernatural. He's preaching to the birds, as everyone knows about, which, it sounds like a nice little fable, but, imagine all of a sudden calling the birds and starting to preach to them, and then they're there, lined up in their pews. Okay, maybe not their pews, but all the Marian apparitions, and I guarantee you, a whole talk will be based specifically on Marian apparitions. Isn't everything a miracle? Again, I would like to look at the whole world through the lens of everything being a miracle. It's a much better way, in other words, with the eyes of faith than not. But when speaking of miracles, people sometimes refer to natural events. Oh, the sunrise, and somehow it's equated with a miracle. Is it a miracle? Well, that God created the universe and everything? Sure, if you want to go that far. But it is something on the natural order. Now that God has created the universe, as he did, on the natural order, there are sunrises. We have the seasons. So the miracle of a birth. We can say that, and maybe some people will say that, but in the true sense of the word, that's in the natural order. All things of beauty in nature, they might be wondrous, but that doesn't therefore make them miracles. Miracles require divine intervention. That's the deal. In other words, as the natural world exists, boom, now there's a miracle. There's an intervention. It's direct. It's supernatural. It's immediate. It is perceivable by the senses. It's for the benefit of those who do not believe. That's the primary recipient of a miracle. And for everyone else who does believe, it's a continued confirmation of our faith. Natural nature, the created physical realm, what humans experience with the senses, and then supernatural, the unseen realm, what human senses cannot experience except by God's direct intervention. At Mass today that you attended, or at 11 o'clock Mass, you're not going to see it happen, but you're going to see some signs that point to it. When the priest puts his hands over bread and wine, because of the Passover that Jesus participated in, the Last Supper, he took unleavened bread, he took wine made of grape, and then but we're going to say, by the God the Father, send your Holy Spirit to change these gifts into the body and blood of Christ that we offer right back to you, what you yourself have given to us. We're not going to see with our eyes literally, but we're going to know with our faith that we have just plugged into an unbelievable part of our faith tradition that goes all the way back to the Last Supper. And even before that, with Jesus foretelling what was going to take place. Miracle. Applying miracle to a sunset is to admit the most important characteristic, God's direct intervention with creation. I think that's understood. Laws that govern nature, but then the logos that brought order out of chaos. Remember, in the beginning was the Word, and the logos, what we've talked about this before, the reason, the logic, that which can order something out of complete chaos, and that, of course, from the very beginning. And when things occur that suspend the laws of that govern nature, there we go. Now we have a notion of a miracle. How do we know miracles occur? Okay, Jesus himself. Again, we believe what sacred scripture says, that, and we do believe that these are direct divine interventions, and at a time in which people needed proof that here he is, this is the Messiah, and everything else that he's saying about on the spiritual realm, therefore, is true. Now we're in the Catechism of the Catholic Church. Jesus accompanies his words with many mighty works and wonders and signs, which manifest that the kingdom is present in him, and attest that he was the promised Messiah. Again, we had a whole class on this, fundamental theology. Father Gerald O'Collins from Australia. His Italian was the best, because he would speak his Italian with his Australian accent. I mean, us Americans, we Americans, we buongiorno ragazzi, come stai? Anyways, great little flashback, thank you. I will refer to this quote again in a moment. Why did Jesus perform miracles, the signs and wonders? By Jesus attest that indeed he was the one sent by the Father. They invite belief in him. Just watching him walk around people, this is more than curiosity. When John the Baptist says, "Behold, the Lamb of God," okay, great, all right, I'm intrigued. But then all of a sudden the heavens open up and the Holy Spirit descends upon him in the form of a dove, and people can actually hear, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased, listen to him." All right, now we have people who used to follow John the Baptist say, "Goodbye, I'm following this guy." Which was perfect. That's exactly what he wanted. He knew he was the precursor. You know, that he had to decrease, he had to increase. Miracles strengthen faith in the one who does his Father's works. They bear witness that he is the Son of God. I mean, in one sense, again, could God have just in one fell swoop, just in an unbelievably dramatic fashion from the sky, everyone's there, and, I mean, you know, made it so evident his divine plan? Well, yeah, I mean, but again, what the Lord wants us to do and has always wanted us to do is not to have faith crammed down us, forced upon us. It's meant to be something that will invite belief, where we can, of our own accord, say, yes, there's that ascent of faith, there's a leap of faith that we have to have. Miracles strengthen faith in the one who does his Father's works. They bear witness that he is the Son of God. So just very quickly, some of the examples, forms of miracles, laws of nature suspended. Miracle of the Son of Fatima, for example. We just had the 100th anniversary. I mean, all of a sudden the sun somehow stops, goes back on its course. Now there is something that is not natural. The laws of nature are suspended. Physical healing beyond the capacity of human medical science. You know, and at times you'll even get some doctors who will say, There's no natural explanation for this. This should not have happened. I would dare say that probably every single person here can recount something like that. Occurrences that defy the natural order. Incorruptible saints, the body is meant to corrupt. That's the natural course of events. You see bodies, people who are saints, and then they go in and they remove their body in order to put it into a special, underneath an altar or a new tomb, and all of a sudden, you know, they've been dead hundreds of years and their body's incorrupt. Isn't that one of our talks too?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so one of our talks will deal with all the incorruptibles. Eucharistic miracles, I mean, and we will definitely get into all of those. Sainthood requires miracles, as I think everyone has heard before. Tomorrow is the 130th anniversary of the canonization of St. John Berkman's. And so our kids, by the way, today, each class, every 15 minutes, they're going to the church. They're kneeling before the relic of the heart of St. John Berkman's. They're hearing more about his canonization. And remember, the third miracle needed for his canonization took place here in our own state. We should all know this story very well. But the very last of our talks will be all of the Vatican-approved miracles that have taken place in the United States. So that'll be the last one. I'm the one giving that. And we'll talk about Grand Coteau, of course. So, two miracles attributed to a person for canonization. If the person is a martyr, that is already something that is counted as one of the miracles. I mean, truly a martyr, not just someone who happened to be killed, but I mean someone who, for the faith, dies. Investigation of miracles. I mean, I don't know if you realize it, but there is a whole congregation for the cause of saints, and they have people investigating the miracles that have been allegedly attributed to the intercession of this particular saint. The intercession, it's not that the saint did it. And even as a part of that congregation, they have the person who plays the infamous role of devil's advocate, who says, these are all the reasons why it's not a miracle, that we should ascribe this to the natural order. In every age, of course, people have refused to believe. We know that. If they do not hear Moses and the prophets, neither will they be convinced that someone should rise from the dead. I mean, Jesus himself knew that there would be plenty of skeptics. The greatest miracle, the resurrection, and we have this relic of the resurrection. Death was overcome. The natural order is there's death, and that's that. Other miracles help us believe and find this truth. I can't wait to talk to you more about this behind us. But I will say this, that Barry Schwartz, who is coming here, if the name doesn't mean anything to you, it will, especially after you've heard him speak. If you've ever watched any documentary on the Shroud of Turin, you know, National Geographic, Discovery Channel, something that one of the, he's always there. He was the photographer for the Shroud of Turin Research Project in 1978. He's the one who took this picture. And he's going to be here. It's a great story that he is going to tell. And the week before that, we're going to talk all about the Shroud of Turin. And you can picture the negative image. We're going to have it up here as well, and a number of other different things related to the Lord's death, his torture. All of this is taking place the week before Holy Week. It's meant to get us ready for Holy Week, to see an actual crown of thorns, cap of thorns, the flagrum, etc. But none of that is miraculous. It's what took place here with the resurrection that we have the miracle. Now, just very quickly, so that I can actually do what the course title says I was supposed to do. talk about miracles. Okay, now, I have as one of my Word documents the entire Catechism of the Catholic Church, which makes it unbelievably easy just to do a search for the word miracle or miraculous. And the word miracle, miracles, miraculous appear in the Catechism 13 times. We're about to see all 13 of them. Some of them we've already seen. But if you're looking for the place, well, one of the places, to really have the church's understanding in verbiage that we use in this day and age, in other words, let them be anathema, that's not in this catechism, then take a look at the catechism, and this is one of the major paragraphs that is always quoted, 156. What moves us to believe is not the fact that revealed truths appear as true and intelligible in the light of our natural reason. We believe because of the authority of God himself who reveals them, who can neither deceive nor be deceived. So that the submission of our faith might nevertheless be in accordance with reason, God willed that external proofs of his revelation should be joined with internal helps of the Holy Spirit. What are those external proofs? Miracles. Miracles. The things that we can see and smell and taste. And then that not just with how the Holy Spirit might be guiding me internally. Thus, the miracles of Christ and the saints, prophecies, the church's growth and holiness, and her fruitfulness and stability are the most certain signs of divine revelation, adapted to the intelligence of all. They are motives of credibility, which show that the ascent of faith, that leap of faith, is by no means a blind impulse of the mind. So this gives, as it were, a really nice summary, definition of what a miracle is, what it does, what it's meant to do. It's supposed to push us, it's a motive of credibility. We can therefore hold credible everything else that is being proposed by our Lord. All right. I didn't think about this, that I'd have to do this each time. So, 434, Jesus' resurrection glorifies the name of the Savior God, for from that time on, in the name of Jesus, that fully manifests the supreme power of the name which is above every other name. The evil spirits fear his name. In his name, his disciples perform miracles. For the Father grants all that they ask in his name. We already saw that one. Um, 468. Maybe I should have just written all this out so you had it right in front of you, but you can write down the numbers if you wish. Thus, everything in Christ's human nature is to be attributed to his divine person as its proper subject, not only his miracles, but also his sufferings and even his death. He who was crucified in the flesh, our Lord Jesus Christ, is a true God, Lord of glory, and one of the Holy Trinity. His deeds, miracles and words. Actually, this whole paragraph is very good. So, I like how this is put. From the swaddling clothes of his birth to the vinegar of his passion and the shroud of his resurrection, everything in Jesus' life was a sign of his mystery. His deeds, miracles and words all reveal that in him the whole fullness of the deity dwells bodily. from the swaddling clothes to the vinegar of his passion. Um, 548 could also be one of those, in fact, I think, yeah. The signs of the kingdom of God. So there's a whole little section in the catechism that deals with miracles, and not just, you know, using it in the context of whatever they're talking about, but talking about miracles per se, the signs, the miracles of the kingdom of God. Jesus accompanies his word. I mean, I guess God just knew that he wouldn't be able to say the words only and people would somehow be convinced to believe. His words needed accompaniment with the mighty works and wonders and signs which manifest his kingdom present in him and attest that he was the promised Messiah. The signs worked by Jesus attest that the Father has sent him. They invite belief, as we heard earlier. To those who turn to him in faith, he grants what they ask. So miracles strengthen faith in the one who does his Father's works. They bear witness that he is the Son of God. But the miracles can also be occasions for offense. They are not intended to satisfy people's curiosity or desire for magic. That's how some of the people in Jesus' time approached him. You know, hey, do this, do that. You know, we want to see this. King Herod, right at the time of the Passion. Despite his evident miracles, some people